From KSMQ in southern Minnesota, this is Off 90.
Funding for Off 90 is provided in part by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota.
I feel, you know, I need to do art. It's just, it's part of me. I have a passion to do it. Unlike a lot of artists, I don't paint constantly. I'll go for some fairly long periods of time not doing art at all. Maybe 3 weeks, maybe 2 months sometimes. This painting is probably about 3/4 of the way done. But then I'm thinking about art. I'm thinking about what I want to do when I get back to it. And then I'll sit down and do art real steadily for weeks at a time. You just have to keep coming to the studio every morning and working at it. It gets to a point when I'm not doing art that I just, at some point, I'm drawn to the studio like a magnet. Try and keep routine hours. And come to work every day and accomplish a certain amount. I know that when I am working, I'm in my best frame of mind. I think I actually found that I enjoyed art way back in elementary school. That's an oil. These are, in fact, both oils. I didn't think that I was as good as some of the people, but I had more interest. That urge to do good art, I think, you know, is just something that was with me from a young child. I think early on it was the challenge. A lot of my friends were wildlife artists, and I'm an avid outdoors person, and so I thoroughly understand the our environment and surrounding. I'm an avid fisherman, fly fisherman, and I'm an avid hunter. You'll find me in a tree most of October and November. This was a friend of mine who has a magazine, a fly fishing magazine. He also has an art gallery. And he asked me if I would do a show, and the theme, of course, centered around fly fishing. So I enjoy my hobbies and my spare time, but my passion for painting always draws me back in the studio. It seems, with all these interests, my friends think I'm retired, but actually I won't let them in the studio when I'm working, so, you know, they only see me when I'm playing. This is a Montana piece, a yee-haw cowboy. And I've already transferred the drawing onto my canvas board. Drawing and painting people is probably the ultimate challenge in art, particularly if you're working in a realistic fashion. I was in Montana traveling down a gravel road, and I came up over a rise, and there were about, I'm guessing, 2,000 Angus cattle coming right down the road at me. There were about 5-6 cowboys pushing these cattle. This was maybe the most interesting part, this detail of the cowboy. I went to St. Cloud State University in Minnesota as an art major, and I never finished school, but the art of that period, which was in the early 70s, pop art and the various styles that seemed to be in vogue, really weren't the kind of art that I enjoy doing. I'm more of a realist. I worked at some odd jobs, got married. This is my favorite model. This is my wife. At some point, I decided that I should become a sign painter. In 1979, a partner, Brad Tracy, joined us, and we started Schad Tracy Signs, and that company still exists today. For 25 years or so, I lettered and was the graphic artist and designer in our sign business, which was, in a way, keeping my hand in art, but it really wasn't the kind of art that I wanted to do. I wanted to paint people and do fine art. This is a painting that seems to be everybody's favorite. Was done in 91. I call it the White Shirt Conversation. About 10 years ago, I stepped back from the commercial sign business. Most of my time I spend nowadays doing fine art. I always say that I'm a people painter. My favorite subject matter is people.
You're that much a part of me now. Remember that night in Montana.
This is a large oil that I did. I have a pond behind my studio. Be careful on the rocks. And two of my nephews and one of their friends were in a canoe in the pond. It was a hot summer day, and they were rocking the canoe and until it would go over, and then they'd get in and push each other out of the canoe. I call this Boys of Summer. I don't try and sensationalize the images. I really think that the most timeless images are just of ordinary people doing ordinary things. I think all artists have been influenced by great artists, usually from the past. A couple of my heroes, I guess you'd say, would be Winslow Homer, Edward Hopper, John Singer Sargent, and Norman Rockwell, all very influential to me. For me, it's painting people. If I can paint them true to life and make an image that shows somebody doing something at a given point in time, exactly the way they were feeling and posturing and doing it, I think there's a certain importance in that and a timelessness. I work in a void, and I'm in my studio, and of course, I live at the end of the road. So I don't see people sometimes for days. And then I like it when the painting's going well. But I also thoroughly enjoy my solitude in the studio, and that's how I prefer to work. At the end of a painting that turns out, I like that. It's just a slice of heaven. We have 40 acres that Connie and I, my wife and I, live on here. Beyond this pile of rocks is prairie, and we have our house and the studio, and I always dreamed of having the ideal studio. Been fortunate enough to be able to fashion the one that I really wanted. So I kind of enjoy the entire process of making a painting, but I feel like I want people to make their own decisions, make their own judgments. I prefer it that way, and whether they like it or not, it's you know, I hope that it moves them. A lot of people say, well, gosh, you were born with this wonderful talent, and I can't draw, you know, a straight line without a ruler. And I always say, I can't either. But if you have an interest, I always felt like I wasn't greatly talented. I just had a wonderful interest in, and wanted to do art. But I've learned most everything. There are people who have always had an interest in art, and for one reason or another, never really were able to or spend a lot of time doing art. And I find that men and women alike will come back and find art to be a real wonderful thing to do. I was, you know, fully occupied in our own sign business, as I've mentioned. But I've really had a passion to do art. So what I did was I took classes on weekends. Just use as much of your time to do art as you can. You're really not born with it. I think you learn it. And so for those who don't think they can do it but want to try, just go ahead and take class. Get out there and try it.
Paramount was built in 1929 on the site of a former theater, the Park Theater, which was built in 1919. But in 1928, it got destroyed by a tornado. And it happened right after a matinee let out, a movie. So it could have been devastating. But no one was in the theater. A year later, they built the Paramount. It was built by the corporation called Publix, which owned Paramount Pictures. And shortly after it was built, Publix decided to take Paramount's name because it was so well recognized. So it's named after the film corporation. The Paramount Theater was built for movies in vaudeville, opened 2 years after the sound technology started in 1927, the talkies, as they call them. They had a big sign painted on the side of the building on the outside that said all talking and singing pictures. So they're very proud of the fact that they didn't need to have, you know, an organ or accompanist to make sound for the movies. But in the 30s, 40s, into the 50s, and even into the 60s, it was a major form of entertainment. People just loved coming to the movies. Of course, you'd want to because it's such an incredibly charming building. And this place was packed many nights a week. One of the reasons it did close was because of the multiplex at the mall. And Sterling Shopping Center, yeah, it was two screens, so they could show two movies that would appeal to, you know, two different types of audiences. Just the movie going public had changed a lot by then. And then in 1975, because of competition from multiplexes, the smaller screens, and TV wasn't financially viable, so they closed. The last movie was Godfather Part II. It's called an atmospheric theater. If you look up at the ceiling in here, you'll see stars and clouds. And the architecture is based on Spanish Moorish architecture. The idea is you come in here, you're not in Austin anymore, or even the United States, but you're in Spain under a balmy summer evening sky. It's asymmetrical. Each section has a different architectural feature, and that's to represent that that's one building, and that's another one, and so it's a Spanish village with buildings all around. Those balconies are obviously architectural features for a building built. It's for aesthetic reasons. Because it was built after the sound technology came about, if it would have had an organ, that's where the sound would from the organ would have come from. They're called organ lofts. So it'd be truly stereophonic. The bigger one, House Left, has been used a number of times for theater. People always say, oh, you should do Romeo and Juliet, and it would be Rapunzel could drop her hair out of there. A lot of people call that the Rapunzel Tower. And a man from Sparta, Wisconsin bought it and turned it into a bar. Took out all the seating and built a false floor on the rake, the slant in the theater floor. The bar sat in the main part of the room, and it was a disco, and they came up on stage and danced. And it was actually very popular. Live music was played here a lot. And its last incarnation was a comedy club called Snickers. So it was open for 10 years as a bar. It cost a lot of overhead. It cost a lot to heat it. And then in 87, it closed. In 1989, a group of people that are on the board of Matchbox Children's Theater here in town, which is a local children's theater, were talking about the possibility of turning the Paramount into a place where they could perform along with other entertainment. And lo and behold, it opened again as a performing arts center. This was the first air-conditioned building in Austin. And outside the building was a well that pumped, and then there was a pump that pumped water into a bunch of nozzles on these pipes that would make a mist, a wall of mist, cold air. The water would cool the air. During the summer, it was very popular. People would come and cool off. And, of course, we don't use that anymore. It's different state-of-the-art air conditioning now. The projectors that we have here now are actually vintage to the era of the late 30s and 40s. And we found those at a Masonic Hall in Twin Cities. And they're like in mint shape. The light source is a carbon arc system, which was extremely bright. Of course, you know, if you can't look at someone welding because it's so bright, and that would be the light source. There were very few people anywhere that actually would know how to operate these. You really need to know how to do it. It's not flipping a switch on. And we installed them here. And the reason there are two projectors here is the film, this is only 20 minutes long. And again, if you had a film that was an hour and a half long, all on one reel, it'd be that big. And you couldn't get it up the stairs and it'd be too heavy. So you put reel one here, start the movie, get the lamp going, start the movie, and people are enjoying it. Reel two would be over here. You'd have that all threaded up, and then there was a changeover mark. They would design it that way in the film. And they come in big cans. They're quite heavy, so the ushers had to bring the film up to the booth. And that's how you learn, or at least back then, how you learned to be a projectionist, was you'd go into a movie place and work for the projectionist, and he'd show you how. So this is the downstairs where the dressing rooms are. They're built for vaudeville, so they're kind of small, so they're tiny. And so when we have 35 people changing costumes, they actually do it on stage behind the curtain. In 1943, they painted over all of the interior, except for the ceiling, painted over everything, just to make it look different, modernize. I don't know for sure what they were thinking, because the paint theme of 1929, which it looks like now is just, well, it's charming, it's wonderful. We do have photos of this because the projectionist at the time, who Harold Davidson, he was a photographer too, and a very good one. One of his favorite subjects was the Paramount. And his photos were invaluable when it came to restoring the place. But of course, all the photos are black and white. And but there, you could see the image. We were able to find an artist who lived in Blooming Prairie. The artist took the paint down, determined what it looked like, and then repainted it all. He used different chemicals, and he took off each layer of paint without disturbing the one right underneath it. And painstaking task. It took him a year and a half, I think he told me, just to do this small room here, the foyer. Because he was basically experimenting with the process, this one artist did like 99% of the work all by himself. It's just really the most important aspect of its restoration. It's kind of like a paint layer history. And he took photos at each stage and then determined what the original looked like. Then he matched colors, made stencils of it, and then repainted it all. So it's a replication of the original. Of course, the P is up there for Paramount. All this decorative, geometrical painting is based on Spanish architecture. And all of this has been restored to the way it looked in 1929. It is on the National Register of Historic Places, so, and the State Historical Society has really applauded what we've done. They really like how accurately we have restored it and how closely we've, you know, tried to make it look the way it did in 1929. It took a lot of work, but now it's up and running as a performing arts center. We do theater, lots of music, dance. We have weddings here, business meetings. A lot of local groups use it. Local schools come and do their choir concerts here. It's, you know, such a wonderful movie palace. Could be 20 below outside January, but you come in here, not only does the entertainment take you to a different place in time, but the actual experience of the building does too.
I would say today's a perfect day. No wind, a little bit of sunshine, wonderful.
A beautiful day.
Today is a gorgeous day. It's not humid, the sun is shining.
Today's a very nice day outside, bright, sunny, couldn't enjoy it more.
Gorgeous day. It's not raining.
Today is the day to be outside enjoying yourself, riding your bike.
I think summer started once the warm weather comes, once you can put on flip-flops and take off your sweater.
When you're no longer in school, that's when summer started.
But there ain't no cure for the summertime blues.
When the grandkids are home and want to spend the night.
When I first start to see the robins coming out.
When I get in the garden and start planting. Ready for a brand new
beat. When I see the trees and leaves budding out.
My favorite thing about summer is spending time with my grandchildren. We like to do summer things together. We go to the zoo, we go to Valley Fair.
My favorite thing about summer is just being outside all the time.
Watching the flowers grow, your gardens grow, riding my motorcycle. Born to be wild.
I enjoy riding. I love being outside.
My favorite thing about summer is I'm not in school and my kids are not in school, so we can wake up as late as we want and play as late as we want. So
my favorite thing about summer is being outside, enjoying nature, bike paths.
Favorite thing about summer is hanging out with friends, having campfires, all that fun stuff. When the weather's fine, you got women
on your mind. If I could change something about the summer, it would probably be the tornadoes and rain. I think that's affected everyone pretty dramatically into how their summer started.
Not working.
Just stay home and get things done that need to be done.
If I could change one thing about summer, I would extend the length of it.
I love summer.
I would make it grow longer. I like summer.
I would marry summer. We're always happy. Last we're living, yeah, that's our philosophy. Sing along with us, dee 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 dee. Da 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 da, yeah, we're happy. Da da da, da 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 da. Da 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 da, right on. Da 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 da.
That's it for now. But join us again next week for Off 90. Meanwhile, let us know what you think and tell us about any interesting people, places, or stories that you want to see here in the coming weeks. Then watch for the KSMQ crew out there, around your town, in our communities, along the back roads. Wherever arts, culture, and history can be found in southern Minnesota, that's where we'll be. But you can be sure we'll always be Off 90.
Funding for Off 90 is provided in part by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota.